Welcome back to Panthera Racing. You might be wondering where the updates to the Mk II Supra have been. Well, it has a lot to do with where I am now, under the car, which is where I've been for several weeks, under the car. Let me explain. You see, this whole wonderful dealy here, this rear suspension subframe holds the diff in, holds the shocks on, control arms, all that kind of stuff, all of that came out of the car. Primarily because all of the bushings, like these guys here, those guys there, you name it, every bushing was completely shot. So wanted to take the opportunity to replace those. While I was here, also found some cracks developing on the CV boots, so replaced those. That's not a fun job, but it's done. New sway bar bushings, got our orientationing. Got our spiffy remote reservoir coilovers installed, went together quite well. Just have to mount the nitrogen tanks at some point soon. But yeah, that all went quite well. Interestingly, I originally was not gonna pull this diff apart. It is a factory LSD diff, and I said, yeah, it'll probably be fine. But given that I found some damage in the transmission, if you've watched the previous videos in this build, I said, you know what, let's pull it apart while it's out of the car. And I'm very glad I did, because there was a spring broken in the LSD hub. So without that, pretty much no LSD. Really, really glad I had the chance to rip it apart and fix it. So why not film any of that stuff? Well, if you've ever done any rear suspension bushing work, pulling diffs out, pulling transmissions out, it's really dirty, generally horrible work that is not very photogenic, and it's also really, really hard to film. So it's 90% dolphin noises and 10% covering my GoPros in gack. So I said, you know what, I'm just not gonna film it. I'll show you what it looks like after it's done. And yeah, it's done. Also, have the entire driveline back in, if you can see. Prop shaft, gearbox, everything all nice and happy. Also have our super spiffy big brake kit on the rear now as well. You can see the caliper up in there, brackets, all that good stuff. I don't think my GoPro likes that light. Anyway, caliper's in, rotor's on, rear brake's done, wheel's on. It's pretty much a roller now, and that's a cool shadow. And I'm super glad I have the transmission back in, because now I can actually park the thing in gear, so it's not gonna roll off to Tahiti the second I look away from it. So as we can see, rear suspension and wheels are on, so now the car does not look out of place with completely mismatched wheels. That is pretty cool. Really glad the fitment worked out. We have plenty of clearance in here for fun activities. And turns out a 17-inch wheel is pretty much what you want on a Mk II Supra. Now, the majority of the work I've been doing to the car in the last few days has actually been on the interior, and that's because the roll cage is now completely, totally finished. It is not totally painted. There's a reason for that. But anyway, she is now totally welded in and ready to rock and roll. I was gonna paint it this morning, but unfortunately the paint I am using has a very, very similar cap, whether it's gray or silver. So instead of getting 6 cans of gray, I got 1 can of gray and 5 of silver. So whatever, it happens, race car life. But we've got all of our cool stuff done. Mounting bracket for the steering rack, which is all good to go. NASCAR door bars on both sides now. Welding the back of these involves a mirror and laying there on top of sharp things. Do not recommend, but hey, race car life. Got our pedal box mounts. The Dale Earnhardt's seat mount mod is now complete. Got our chromoly anchors for our belts. And everything is pretty much ready to get painted and put together on the inside. So that's gonna be happening real soon now. Anyway, let's go build a swirl pot. Why make a swirl pot, you ask? Well, because having air in your cooling system, especially when you're doing long distance endurance racing, is bad. Also, in this particular application, it's gonna make my coolant hose routing way, way easier. So it's kind of a win-win situation. This nifty little kit comes from a place called Track Tough. It's kind of a pre-cut swirl pot. They have a bunch of little kits like this for little race car-y bits. Does save a huge amount of time when you can just buy pipes that are already tulipped and weld your fittings on and go from there. So let's zap this guy up. And just like that, we've got a swirl pot. If you're wondering what these are for, if you don't know, well, let me show you. So typically on most liquid-cooled engines, you'll have a radiator of some sort, unless it's really interestingly liquid-cooled, and your hot water will come out of the water neck on right here and go into the hot side of your radiator. On this particular application, as you can see, I have a bit of an issue with routing because radiator very close to water neck. And yes, I could put like a 90 degree on the water neck, I could change this up, I could cut stuff, I could do all kinds of dumb stuff to make this work. But because I wanted a swirl pot anyway, this pretty much worked out well, as now I can take this little guy and stick it right about here, and now I've got a straight shot to both of my fittings. And will you stay? You will not stay. Anyway, the way swirl pots work is your hot water, your hot water comes out of the water neck, goes into the top of the pot, swirls around a bit, and then comes out the bottom where it goes into the hot side of the radiator, gets drawn across or down if you have a downflow radiator, by the water pump and back into the engine. And what the pot essentially does is let any air that is trapped in the hot coolant separate its way out of the coolant. So it's a really effective way of getting air out of the coolant. Additionally, because I am running a cross flow rad here, if you don't know much about cross flow rads, they generally run fairly low cap pressures because the cap is on the fill cap is on the cold side. So this setup lets me run a higher pressure cap on the high side, low pressure on the low side. As one thing about racing, at least any racing I know about, you can't use any kind of glycol or any kind of antifreeze in your coolant. It's just straight water and maybe a little water wetter. And that does limit the temperatures you can get away with unless you do tricks to raise the pressure. So, swirl pot goes there. Pretty awesome. One thing I will say about this kit from TrackTough, really great little kit, saved me probably 3 or 4 hours of fab just by having most of the pieces. So they specify a Type B Honda style radiator cap, like from a Acura or a Civic or a CRX or something from the 90s. I found that not to be the case, at least on the kit I got. What you want is a Type A cap from pretty much any 90s or early 2000s Toyota. Those fit great. And now, due to the magic of time, we have a swirl pot. We also have a radiator installed with a pretty cool bracket and a big boy fan installed and our intake tube made and our Sparky Boys mounted and the Sparky Boy wires, fuel pressure reg, power steering reservoir. It's all coming together in a mad thrash, as is typically the case when you build race cars. So we are making quite a bit of progress in quite a short amount of time. All that's really left in the engine bay is to mount the oil cooler, the second fan, and the reason there's going to be a second fan is my original plan with this setup was to use the same dual fan setup I have on the Mark IV, and I ordered it based on the measurements of this radiator. I'm like, oh great, it's gonna fit, I can use the same fan, I'll have a spare fan, awesome. Pulled out of the box, put it up the radiator, and I, whoops. So, as this is a cross-flow radiator, you can see the end tanks make up a substantial part of the width. Now, I ordered the same fan for the Mark IV, which has a downflow radiator, because I thought this 25-odd inch dimension was going to work with those fans. It does not, because the core is several inches narrower. So, custom fan set up here for the majority of the radiator, and there's also going to be another puller behind the oil cooler, which is gonna go right here. So, collectively, still gonna have two fans, still gonna have great flow. It's just, well, I guess I have a spare set of cooling fans for my Mark IV. Eh. Anyway guys, that's gonna pretty much do it for this episode. A little bit shorter than usual, as I mentioned, I've been thrashing on this thing and a lot of it's just been really dirty, grimy, horrible work. So we're probably gonna have one more major update on the car, which is gonna be with all the wiring finished when I do the first start and hopefully take it to the dyno and not find 20 or 30 major problems that I have to solve before we go race this thing. So thanks for tuning in. If you want to subscribe, go ahead and hit the button down there. Leave a like, leave a comment. I do read pretty much all of my comments, time allowing, of course. But until next time, see you later.